this good of you to me?
You're okay over here.
That's a technical problem. I'm not solving technical problems. Not my job. Sorry.
Can I speak without microphone? I feel much more comfortable this way, and I love more. So a couple of things. Rules, no rules. Feel free to ask questions at any point. What?
Okay. No rules. Feel free to ask questions at any point in the James Best tradition. I can ignore your question, but I'll try to return back to it at some point. Uzi, all of you hopefully try to use MapReduce, love it, it does great things. There are two big problems. Problem number one, very rarely a single MapReduce job solves the problem. In order to solve real life problems, you need to string multiple MapReduce jobs together. Whoa! Okay. Now Timur is going to try to fix the projector, so look that way. The second problem is, although there is a command line interface to invoke MapReduce jobs in real production, using this command line interface every time you need to invoke something is kind of hard. That's why Dupe has its own workflow solution, which is Uzi. Apache Uzi, it became Apache project about a year ago, is probably one of the most under-evaluated Apache projects. Up until recently, the only information about Uzi was documentation. In the latest Hadoop Bible, there is three pages dedicated to Uzi. I was curious, so I counted. So a single Uzi server implements all four functional Uzi components, which are Uzi Workflow that a lot of people heard about, Uzi Coordinator, which very few people heard about, Uzi Bundle that I'm sure nobody have heard about, and Uzi SLA, which I'm also sure nobody have heard about, and we'll try to cover all four of them. So main components of Uzi. Uzi is a fork, which typically runs in the Tomcat application server. It has a database where it stores all of its information. It's connected to Hadoop, so Uzi knows exactly where Hadoop cluster is, and it has both APIs and command line interface. One of the things that people use more commonly is Uzi Workflow. Uzi Workflow is a very simple, very lightweight workflow engine, which was influenced by GPPM, and he has a language very similar to GPPM, which is called GPDL, HPDL, Hadoop PDL. And unfortunately, unless you go to a company like IBM, there are no editors. So if you are like me, XML geek, it's pretty easy to write Uzi Workflow. If you hate XML, well, you're out of luck, because you still have to know it to be able to write workflows. So as I said, Uzi provides the minimal workflow language, which basically has four flow control elements, and it has a handful of action nodes. So in a nutshell, it allows you to start and end the process, it allows you to fork and join, and it allows you to switch inside the process. It allows you to invoke MapReduce, Pig, Hive, whatever is provided by Hadoop. In addition, it has support for Hadoop file system, and it allows you to write custom Java nodes, which is the way out for most of the people that are using Uzi, because custom Java node basically write whatever you want and he faithfully logs it and executes it.
Question.
Yeah.
So the Java code, where does it execute? On the server or?
Okay, so I'm playing Jim right now. Hang on. We'll come back to this later. I was saying, Jim, the way you've been ignoring my questions, I can ignore everybody else's. this is introduction to the next slide. So UCI provides two types of workflow actions. There are synchronous workflow actions and asynchronous workflow actions. Most of the actions are executed asynchronously, including MapReduce, including Hive, including Java action. So what UCI does in the case of the Java action, it creates a MapReduce job which has a single mapper, and your Java class is executed inside the mapper. So it might seem like a lot of overhead. In reality, it's actually quite convenient because first of all, you can run thousands of processes on fairly small UCI server because UCI server doesn't do much. It just dispatches the request to Hadoop, and Hadoop is typically big enough cluster that is capable of executing everything that you need. The second thing is Hadoop cluster already has all the reliability and all the ability qualities that are implemented inside it. So UCI doesn't have to implement any of this. The only thing that UCI is doing is it's trying to retry to submit the job to Hadoop if the first time fails. Once the job is submitted to Hadoop, cluster is up to the cluster to ensure that the job is executed to the very end. Yes, every self-respected workflow, UCI workflow have its own life cycle. It is when you upload your workflow definition to the UCI server, it is in the prepared state. Once you start your workflow, it's running, and obviously you can either fail or succeed, or you can kill it, or you can suspend it. UCI also comes with a traditional tool, which is called UCI console, which allows you to see the state not only of the workflow, but also of card maker. It also allows you to link to the, it also allows you to link to chat tracker so that you can go between UCI information about the running job to the chat tracker so that you can see what this thing is doing in the Hadoop. And I mean, especially if you are running Java actions in UCI, sometimes it can be a little bit deceiving. Because typically from UCI you will see two Hadoop jobs, launcher job and the actual action execution. One of the nice features about UCI is extensibility. They deliberately provide a very simple minimal language, but they provided a very powerful ways to extend this language. Pretty much whatever you write can be wrapped up and become a part of the UCI workflow, become a feature in the workflow that you can use. And this is very convenient in two different things. First of all, it is very convenient because the functionality that you implement over and over again you can wrap up as a specific action and refer to it by name. The second, it allows you to bridge the semantics of UCI, which is very Hadoop semantic, with the semantic of the business that you are in. So you can create specific actions that reflect the things that are relevant for the business that you're doing. With the workflow client is another nice feature of Ouzi. Obviously, the same way as everything else in Hadoop, Ouzi provides command line interface, but it also provides both REST services. For some reason, they call it web services APIs. And it provides Java APIs. Why is it important? In reality, yes, you can use Ouzi to string together the MapReduce jobs that you're executing on the Hadoop cluster, but really you are running things just on the Hadoop cluster. Typically, it becomes part of the bigger enterprise process that you have to deal with, and just some of the steps are executed on Hadoop. So, for example, one of the things that we have done here in Nokia, we are using IBM's Lombardi BPM for controlling most of our processes. We built the integration link between Lombardi and Ouzi, which allows us to include Ouzi execution inside the bigger enterprise processes. And there is also Java APIs that we've been using for this. They are actually quite convenient, and we'll talk a little bit more about Java APIs later here. So to sum up, Ouzi workflow is both good, bad, and done. The good thing is great integration with Hadoop, so spawning Hadoop jobs is quite simple. It knows about execution of the Hadoop jobs. It allows you to do things very carefully. Bad thing is absence of the GUI tools for building the workflows. I mean, typically when we've been working with some of the developers, we force them to draw the picture first. Piece of paper, we will translate the picture into XML documents. There is no support for Uber jars, and this is Alex's favorite pet peeve. The majority of people that are running MapReduce jobs are packaging them into Uber jars so that they don't override the same names. For some reason, Uzi doesn't understand this. The addition to Ouzi that allows the process Uber jars. Ouzi was built from the beginning as direct acyclic graph, which means no loops, which means no dynamic forking. And this becomes kind of painful because if you need to loop execute MapReduce job in the loop, you have to do it in the driver outside of Ouzi.
Going back, Boris actually found out some way to fix this last problem too, because you could regenerate dynamically workflows, and he did it and discovered and asked some people to write an article, but people were lazy and didn't do it yet.
He's thinking about himself.
Well, first it was not me.
Go
second. Okay, so with the coordinator. Well, actually, it's not enough to have a kind of chain of jobs which follow each other in some kind of predefined order in workflow and pass data to each other, because the life is more complicated and applications are more complex. So what about jobs which are supposed to run on timer every like 15 minutes or every day? What about jobs which depend on each other, and suppose you run some job which takes log files from our server and transfer those logs on HDFS every 15 minutes, but you want to process them not that often because it's not enough data, it's complicated algorithm, so you want to process them when you have like 12 hours. Actually, it's one real use case. Another use case was probes, which we have in Nokia here. So we get probes during the whole day, all the time, but once a day we run program which application which actually pick up all files which are available, and in this case you want to have some predefined dependencies. You want to be sure that data are ready. So you have way to express that one application should actually check first the availability of data and then only to run. If it's not available, then it will run later. And some more complicated dependencies which you could express with UZI coordinator. UZI coordinator this way allow you to build what they call in specifications data pipelines. In general sense, when there are a bunch of applications and they all participate in processing data, and coordinator intelligently check all conditions, predicate how they call it a specification, predicate put based on time, put based on data availability, and specification also mentions external events which UZI, in reality is not supported yet, but probably it will come. The main elements of coordinator language, which of course derived from XML, are coordinator application, where you specify frequency of job start time and end time. The start time and end time they call nominal start time and nominal end time, because in reality it would start later because of resource availability, because of data availability, or some other reason. The so-called call controls, which specify kind of exceptional conditions and the restrictions. Time out, if application doesn't start soon enough, then it would start at all, would cancel. If concurrency level also you could restrict, because then you would overload cluster with hundreds of delayed instances of job. Coordinator action actually it's where you specify workflow to run, and then there are these three dependent elements data set, input event and output event. That's where you specify dependency, data dependency between applications. So data set actually specifies data which is supposed to be available, and this is global definition. It could be reused in many applications. And this data dependency normally very heavily parameterized with expression language. Normally for as parameterization you use time. So you specify year, month, week, day, hour, minute, second, if you want milliseconds, where this data collection is supposed to be generated, and then if it's nominal time. So it's not real time, so in reality it could be generated later, but it's nominal time and name will come from nominal time. So next application which is supposed to process data knows that this is data which it expects. Of course, coordinator has its own life cycle, and I put some marks here, not only put states, but also conditions where actually one state comes to another. Of course, it has waiting. So waiting states it's where coordinator UZI engine decide that it's time, it's nominal, normally it's nominal time when workflow should supposed to be start. But it will first check data condition. So it will delay workflow in waiting state until data is ready. Then it moves to ready state. Ready state it's again some point to check some other conditions. This is kind of internal performance conditions. So UZI control that it could be very many instances of the same application in this situation which were delayed. So it wouldn't allow you to run hundreds of thousands of instances. If concurrency level just restrict this number of instances which could run in parallel. Actually, it's number of instances which are in ready state plus running instances. Then, if concurrency level doesn't prevent workflow instance to run, it will go to submitted state. And then it's up to schedule, resource scheduler on cluster already to run or to delay more this application. And of course, there is this timeout and killed. And the timeout, it goes to timeout if it's waiting too long. Then it's timeout and then it will never stop. Okay, and we will return a little bit to Garzinetto, but now with the bundle. With the bundle, it's some layer on the top of Garzinetto, which is very restricted in functionality, but still pretty useful. And in case in Yaku way, where they mostly lead the development of new things, they claim that they put all their application into bundles because it's kind of more convenient and allowed to automate to achieve a next level automation. So bundle actually is nothing more than collection of coordinators. So and bundle also has time when it starts, it has frequency and all these parameters, but you operate on the level of collections of coordinator applications. So if coordinator actually run one workflow, which is collection of job, then bundle can in some sense similar way treat collections itself, treat coordinators itself, though the structure inside coordinators and bundles flat, just collection, nothing else. Bundle has its own life cycle, and it's interesting point that the life cycle of coordinator in previous specification included like twice more state than it is now. It's normal practice in its development to introduce some complexity and then to eliminate this complexity. So there are pretty ugly states and names in this bundle life cycle, but because it's very, very young, it still didn't go to this cycle of getting more simple and more efficient. So it's kind of interesting example how actually life cycle of development of such type of projects happen. Besides, there is even more, even kind of less known feature of OOSI, which is called OOSI SLA. OOSI SLA also specified in workflow and in coordinator with XML schema, and it actually appeared pretty long time ago, but it has pretty restricted usage. SLA allow you to declare actually things. It doesn't allow you to really monitor things. It actually is kind of set of declaration and description which allow you to build monitoring system on the top of this.
It's a little bit more OOSI SLA system actually stores the data that can be used by the monitoring system.
Right. OOSI SLA stores the nominal time when so OOSI SLA could be applied on three levels, on level of action, on level of workflow, and on level of coordinator. And for each of this level, it's allowed to specify some parameters, and because it has some kind of links, which I'll show on the next slide, to other tables. This is actually, by the way, the schema of OOSI database. So SLA is just one of tables, and it's allowed you to navigate to other tables. Right, of course, but I see. I do it myself. So it's allow you to get more information about coordinators, about workflow and particular action, if you know the entry point in the SLA table. And the SLA table actually contains nominal times. You don't know when the job actually finished, actually, or even when it started. To dig this information, you need to travel on the stairs. But it's allow you to build monitoring system, and one of the examples of such monitoring system is grid monitoring system, which Yahoo uses internally, which completely gets usage of SLA. I also know some blog, in some blogs, some statement and discussion that people actually building monitoring system using SLA themselves. This is a picture which where I try to show the whole kind of complexity of OOSI and jobs which run under OOSI control on cluster. Its picture shows some kind of hierarchy, and each of this level of hierarchy brings its own kind of dependencies and its own uncertainty how actually job will be running practically. So the first level is what this. Is bundle, right? And then bundle has its own conditions. So bundle would not be submitted to execution if conditions are not right. If condition satisfied, then coordinator will be submitted. Coordinator checks its own conditions, data conditions, time conditions, and all. And again, it could be delayed in submission. And but if condition satisfied, then it goes next step to workflow. And workflow has its own condition actually, because workflow is more or less predefined sequence of actions. So you have job, fork and join, of course, but other than that, actions are predefined in predefined sequence. So it's again, and then on the top of this, there is a resource scheduler, which also could delay particular actions or even cancel them if something with high priority come and if it's a case of policy. So all this kind of regulation of what actually running in Hadoop looks pretty complex, and Uzi nevertheless kind of gets full information about what's happening and allow you to make it available for you. You could see it, you could analyze it, and you could even run your monitoring system with SLA, which will report violation of SLA. Now I'm giving you some very simple examples. Hopefully it will be short. So let's consider.
Nobody from Probe is here, right?
Actually, it was an example from Probe initially, but now it's example from some new POC which I am starting, where it's about analyzing probes and social data to verify places and to get information about places, to get some kind of social face of place. So anyway, it's some philosophy. So suppose we have several steps which we want to implement. So we get, first of all, we get probe data from huge repository which exists already in SLA. We get new probe data, which because we, or some period of time, which we selected to analyze for suppose 3 months. Then we want to do filtering of this data, because probes, they reflect not people which are staying in a particular place, but also traffic, people who just driving cars. So there are ways. So there are ways to filter it in a reasonable way. Then we calculate statistics, then we do chill tile, which is typical for a company like ours, to distribute data between tiles. And then we do a real kind of analysis of probes which belong to particular places. And there are some requirement that it should be reported success or failure and all this things normally. So this is the picture which I draw in Visio, not with pen and pencil, but it's probably similar to what Boris did with his developers. So it's kind of graphical representation of actions, of workflow actions with Visio. So these steps which I mentioned before, it's presented here, so and with some particular action. So the first task I selected to use Java action, for the second task, validation and filter and transformation, I suppose I want to use if action. Then I have some checkpoint, this triangle where I check and stop process if it's under wrong, or and send email or continue. Then I use some fork and join to run in parallel to processes, and then when it joins, I run one more. So it's more or less typical, very simple, extremely simple acyclic graph for this task which I mentioned. Actually, in reality, it will be probably twice bigger if I want to build it for the task which I described before, but it will look something like this. And this how, so acyclic graph you still can understand more or less. Much harder to understand real workflow.
By trying to say that Uzi is good, why is scary?
Yeah. Because you see, I took only part of this workflow which stands behind this diagram, but it's, so in reality it's probably 4 pages. But this is how it moves, just to give you something, the notion that you didn't play with this. So you do it by hands in some XML editor, or you could be more clever, but we don't disclose how to. Okay, so
if there are no questions,
then.
Okay, now that you think that you are used to his accent,
switch back.
Some tips and tricks from the Uzi usage. Configuring workflow. When we first started using Uzi, it was kind of confusing because Uzi provides 3 different places to where you can specify exactly the same set of parameters. And we finally decided to use certain rules, at least internally. The parameters that are specific for the given workflow instance should be in the command line. The remain unresolved parameters should be in JavaFT, and something that applies to pretty much any process should be in config default XML. The second question was not simple to start with again, because the amount of documentation was very, very little. Workflow is great. All the graphs that Alexey was drawing are great. The problem is, if you can't pass the data around, it's pretty much useless. So in this slide, we kind of show how to do this, how to pass the data between the steps. Validating data presence. This is another design decision that you guys have to make on your own, because as Alexey was saying, on one hand you can do it through Coordinator, and it has some advantages because inside the Coordinator you can specify how long you should wait for the data and so on and so forth. But on the bad side, if you're doing this in Coordinator, it's kind of hard to notify somebody that the data is not there. So in case when you really need to take actions when the data is not there, you have to resort back to the custom Java nodes from which you can check the data presence and do all the actions that you have to do. My previous job is another interesting question. By default, OSI provide MapReduce action. If you feel adventurous, I suggest you try it. We tried it a couple of times, and it was very complicated to describe it. I think Alexey had like 5 pages, which he was trying to write to explain how to do this correctly. So this is one of the problems. The second problem is, you never actually test your MapReduce inside OSI. Typically, you test your MapReduce standalone, you have your driver, and then destroy the driver and move all the driver logic inside MapReduce action. Doesn't seem like the right thing to do. So that is the second way of invoking MapReduce action. You can invoke it as a Java node. There is one little caveat in this. If you invoke MapReduce action as OSI MapReduce action, OSI knows about your mappers and your reducers. So if the step is canceled by OSI, it will cancel everything. If you run your MapReduce job from OSI as a Java action, you can have orphans, because OSI by itself doesn't know about mappers and reducers that you are running. So there is a very simple solution for this. You can use Java shutdown hook. So when the driver is killed, it kills all of his descendants. Predefined looping and forking, this was one of the things that Alexey was referring to. In the cases, and we came across a couple of these cases, where we are in the middle of the execution and we kind of know how many loops we need or how many forks we need. So OSI doesn't allow us to do this, but we're trying to be creative. At the end of the day, HPDL is just an XML. So you can happily use JavaSphere to generate HPDL that you need on the fly with the amount of forks or repeating the same thing multiple times as if it was a loop. One of the developers, he is not here, of course he's not here. We wrote code with him and the solution works just fine. So what you do is the dynamic piece becomes your sub-process. So inside the main process, you generate HPDL for your sub-process and then invoke it from your main process, and it works as a champ. this was another interesting experience. When we were doing integration of Fuzi with Lombardia, one of the things that we've noticed, security didn't work. Because if you run Fuzi client, by default, it takes the security credentials from the machine on which you are running it. So if God forbid, your security credentials don't correspond to the security credentials on your HDFS, nothing is going to go. There is a very simple hack that is written here that I've done that solve this problem easily. And Alex's favorite, Ubercharge.
Last slide. So we are close, well close. So it's interesting that when people design some new project, they it's a typical case where programmer doing some job, so he sees some kind of task how, from his point of view, but he doesn't know how user will be using it sometimes. And then normally he doesn't test it, and then later it come out that it's untested or that is not doing what it's supposed to do. The same thing happened with Fuzi in this particular case, because the designer had some model how Fuzi will be used, and they just didn't happen to think about Uber files. A Hadoop designer, they did think about Uber files. So to Hadoop job, you can submit Uber file. Uber file, by the way, one of the term which used for jar which contains resources inside, other jars, zip files, Linux libraries, for instance, things like this, all kinds of resources. In particular, jar which contains other jars inside is very common case. In team where I work for, they build jar which contains other jars, and my first idea was just to use Maven to flatten this thing to class level. But it happened, of course, that people normally use some predefined type of projects where they have the same name for different kind of things, and different projects the same names we use, and when you flatten it, they override each other, and nothing works. So I looked how Hadoop treat this over jars and repeated for Fuzi, but not inside Fuzi, but outside Fuzi, client side. So, which actually also allowed us to figure out some trick how to do some other stuff. Basically, the trick is to get a local file system. Normally, with WebReduce, with Mapper or Reducer running, you don't do something with local file system. It's completely outside of the scope of your program, and that's what Hadoop is doing for you. But you can actually, without big problems, to find what is a temporary file, which a temporary directory, which Hadoop task tracker created for your mapper, and actually this directory completely open. You could write there anything, you could read there, it's on class path, you could put jars and create class loader which will know about those jars and use them. So this way I resolved problem with Uber jars for Fuzi, but also later the same way, the same trick worked for several other use cases, like when you you know that when you use Hadoop, you normally you very often use configuration file to specify some parameters. But if it's run from Fuzi, Fuzi doesn't know where this configuration file is. So one trick just to copy this configuration file to this local file directory and have it there. You have it on HDFS and Hadoop know where it's on HDFS, but you copy the local file directory and then Fuzi reads it. Another trick, pretty sophisticated with Solr. We try to use Solr for pretty big jobs, and it's really slowed down the whole system. Because if hundreds of mappers try to go to one Solr, if it's in a cloud, it's still very slow. But actually, you could use Solr inside mapper, but in this case, Solr needs to keep index somewhere. If you keep in Solr index in memory, it takes too much space, and eventually, that's pretty severe restriction. But if you know where local directory is, open for any your application, you could build Solr index in this local directory for running mapper in setup, and then it also resolves many problems this way. So with Fuzi, you as Boris told you before, and then as I give example now, you actually should be inventive. It's open source after all, and there are a lot of things which are not specified, and you can use them. and eventually you would donate your code and maybe it became a standard if you like. If not, then they'll give this back and use it and give you another way, kind of legal way to do the same.
Like in which case you are not allowed to connect your code back. Sorry.
Okay. Now, I don't know why Boris didn't mention it, probably left to me, but he started saying that there's no nothing to read about Uzi.
All right. Any questions?
Server crashes, how do you recover? It depends. In general, very unpleasant. if this happens, not good. The problem is, even though Uzi server doesn't do much, most of the work is done by Hadoop. Uzi kind of lose its mind, and it doesn't know where you are at the moment. It attempts to recover, but not always.
But let me go ahead. Actually, in last Hadoop conference a year ago, this guy from Yahoo, who is now maybe the name, Allah Muhammad, his name. Anyway, in his presentation, he said that they are working on making cluster of Uzi servers. So in this case.
Yeah, for the last 3 years.
Yeah, it's a year after that, it's not there yet, but at some point it probably will be.
I mean, in general, when you think about workflow servers, clustering is the last thing that people do. They never think that workflow server ever goes down, and it goes down on the daily basis.
No, just use it.
I
No, not really. Think about this way. Typically, Uzi server is running on the edge node using dedicated MySQL instance. So, unless you do something really ridiculous, but don't do that. We've seen problems with Uzi performance and scalability when we were trying to use it on in-memory database, but this was kind of expected. The moment we switched to a SQL server, to MySQL, no.
Yeah.
Can you repeat it?
Does Uzi work with the Hadoop streaming job? See, I'm hardcore Java developer. I don't give
but streaming job. But I know the answer. With the specification, workflow particularly considered streaming job at pipes and all this type of jobs.
It
supports. How well it works, I don't
know. I'm going to try it.
But it works.
You should know that we're Java shop. You came from here. Yeah. What do you mean by human? Which one is it? See, the thing here is, if you want to chain my previous jobs, do it in one place. Don't do it in both places. It makes no sense. I understand what you're saying, but chaining means one after another after another. You can do the same thing with this.
Give me a rough order of magnitude of typical step going off to Hadoop, typical step for how long it takes for the workflow engine to run. I'm asking because sometimes you misapply or find workflow engines apply to something that is running too fast for them to schedule. So if I'm figuring that when you do Hadoop, These are really long-running jobs. That's my guess. Can you tell me what you're doing in practice?
Well, in practice, and Nina, how long is Yoma produced jobs?
Some of them half an hour, but those are multiple. Other times it's 10, 15 minutes. So we have multiple also, that like one of them finishes in five minutes, the other one is continuing and the results are to be completed.
I mean, the bottom line, unless your action runs for 0.0005 seconds, you're good.
Anyway, again, it's claim we didn't do it ourselves. We can do to create some load on Uzi server. But the claim from Yahoo guys is that they run thousands and thousands of jobs at the same time on one Uzi server, and it works for them.
We don't run thousands. We probably run several hundred during the day. And again, once we switch to MySQL, we never see the problem.
Yeah. Is there a concept of the composite jobs, like you can merge stuff together and reuse those?
This is called sub-workflow. Sub-workflow. So you can, Uzi allow you to use any workflow as a sub-workflow. They have sub-workflow node. So from any workflow, you can invoke sub-workflow and pass the parameters.
So, having house a job scheduler, sort of, say houses or anything in that range, do I want to lose you or just lose?
Well, this is a very hard philosophical question. I would prefer to take it, but I can't control myself. I have to answer.
It is a loaded question.
I know it is. See, I'm a true believer. I mean, first of all, when you're talking about job scheduler, what exactly are you talking about? Because there are two different flavors of job schedulers. Are you talking about something? I'm sorry. Are you talking about something like Control-M?
Control-M houses something
wrong. See, Control-M is the most annoying one. Because with Control-M, they claim that they can load balance the jobs.
I've used houses before, so.
At which point I'm saying, guys, are you nuts? You're running on Hadoop cluster. It's doing load balancing for you. You don't need load balancing. So this is one thing. The second thing is, we still have the internal battle whether to use Uzi or to use M. You can kind of guess which side of the fence I am at.
Uzi or what?
And. You know this ugly thing that goes and bites you?
I
know.
What is M? Is it another open source?
And?
The build tool.
Yeah,
oh, and you want to use it as workflow?
Well, I don't. And when I'm trying to tell people wake up, it's 2012 already and it's ending.
That's the beauty of Apache. It always gives you two things to do the same thing.
I would say five. There is nothing that I can do about it. See, unfortunately for both of us, or fortunately, we are architects. So we are not asked when the development is going on. Development has their own managers and they have the final word.
So, any road work for Uzi in light of MapReduce 2?
What is MapReduce 2?
Right.
Right.
So, what do you think MapReduce 2 is? Can I ask this question first?
So, for me, it's capability to run multiple framework on the same cluster.
Right. So let's start from a couple of definitions. My previous two is a horrible misnomer that confused the crap out of Hadoop community. So MapReduce 2 has nothing to do with MapReduce.
Yes.
MapReduce 2 is a simple resource manager, very simple one, and there is three others that are in the works. Because MapReduce 2 is coming from Hortonworks, IBM has their own version, and MapBar is playing with their own version. But regardless of the resource manager that you are running, your MapReduce is still MapReduce. So from UZI point of view, MapReduce 2 is around.
But will it be able to manage? So if you have...
Felix, remember, UZI runs outside of Hadoop, not inside of Hadoop.
Correct. So for example, if you are doing the analytic job, right, and you want to run your UZI flow, then we want to run some other flow on a different framework. I would like it to be controlled by a single, you know,
See, here is another thing that you have to realize about MapReduce 2. I mean, I had this lengthy conversation with Hortonworks, why, how, when. MapReduce 2 is a resource manager, which means that although resource manager supports the APIs, average developer like you and me shouldn't use these APIs, ever. So the APIs that we are using are the either MapReduce APIs that are invoking MapReduce jobs, or for example, Storm APIs that invoke Storm jobs. So from UZI point of view, you invoke the APIs that you need, which means that they will coexist on the Hadoop cluster.
So maybe.
No, for sure. For sure, because from UZI point of view, you are invoking high-level APIs that are utilizing resource manager under the covers. I wouldn't call it schedule because it has a little, I mean, the lines are so blurry. They're really so blurry in reality. And I would say the biggest advantage of UZI is the intimate understanding of how Hadoop works. And because of this, it communicates directly, for example, with the job tracker. It knows exactly where to go to find things out. For example, when you start a MapReduce job, it registers callback at the job tracker, and it is called back when the MapReduce job is complete. But even if it doesn't get the callback, it knows to go to the job tracker and check, am I done? You can do all this with any system, but you will probably spend a lot of efforts building this particular integration piece. And I mean, our recommendation for the most part, use UZI to integrate MapReduce jobs. Use other systems and integrate it with UZI. For example, with Alexi, we've done integration between Control-M and UZI because our tech ops wanted to run everything through Control-F. My answer was, yeah, guys, run this. You would never know that I'm using UZI under the covers. Steve, no questions?
Yes. If you need more information, like, is there some place to go apart from the user mailing list or UZI?
How much? How much?
You can talk to Boris directly.
No, I don't take POs, just cash.
Well, interesting thing about it is that user list
for attention than to their support. The same people actually answering, but they answering faster and more of them. Because I get something to call there, pay money, and you have answer quicker. And you have some advantage, like you allow them to reward a lot to your cluster, for instance, and do something really, or even come and do. But if the question is not very technical about like at a low level, if it's kind of more general, then user list is much more.
We're still paying money to Cloudera, so we go to Cloudera.
So everyone will answer, and then actually happens faster. The same people from Cloudera answer faster actually.
Yeah, because Cloudera is their job and mail is their passion, so they're spending more time on the mail.
All right.